Morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us again for this time of prayer, worship, and the Word. We're on day 14 of our quarantine. It hasn't been easy, but it has been life-changing as well. During this time, I got reminded of the three simple things about life that are precious. The first one is people are precious. It's been amazing how you're looking for to keep your connections with friends, with people you know, and hearing the difficulties of people you know, what they're going through has reminded you how precious life is. Secondly, family is precious. This extended time with family has been a blessing. This extended time of conversations with every member of our family, from the youngest to the eldest. This time to pray together as a family. This time to process the Word of God with the different things we're facing as a family has been indeed precious. And the third thing is, time with God and His Word is life-changing. We may be quarantined in our place, feeling we don't have much to do or there's nothing much we can do, but God's work is still changing us. God's presence is changing us. His Word is still true. Prayer is a powerful thing we can do. Worship is life-changing. And it is our hope that as we continue to pray and worship God this morning, that His presence, His power, His grace will continue to change us. So let us pray as we prepare our hearts for worship. Lord, we thank You, Lord God, for another day that we can walk with You despite the limitations of where we are right now. Thank You, Lord God, that we can be used by You even in this time where we are limited. You can use our voice, You can use our heart, You can use our faith to make a difference in our world. Thank You, Lord God, that even while we're seated, as we're trusting You, You are changing things in our nation. Thank You, Lord God, that we have a God that we can trust despite the challenges we face today. May we continue to grow in You. May we continue to delight in Your presence. May we continue to mature spiritually even in these next weeks that we have the time to pray, to worship You, and to read Your Word.
When I'm lost in the darkness, You remain as my light. In the pain, in the sadness, oh, You will hold my hand tight. Open my eyes to see Your glory. Seek, Lord, Your love is here, Your mercy near, Your love is greater. Oh, love so deep, it's all I need, Your love is greater. Strength and our God. Now with all of creation, our praises rise. Open my eyes to see Your glorious face. Kagandahan mo ay pagmasdan, pag-ibig mo sa kitugo. Kailan may di pa babayaan sa iyo lamang. Matatagpuan sa sasambahin ka sa dakong di mananatili sa'yo lilim nang masumpungan ka sa dakong di. Kalinga at sandigan ko, di nagpapago pangako mo. Salita mo'y panghahawakan sa iyo lamang. Matatagpuan sa iyo lamang. Sa'yo lamang ibig. sa'yo magpakailanman. Ang papuri ko tanging sa'yo, sa'yo lamang inialay. Panginoon, ang puso ko sa'yo lamang.
Lord, thank you, Lord God, that life is simple. Even when things are going crazy around us, life is simple. Lord, we thank you, Lord, that we can enjoy the simplicity of your presence that brings peace and comfort even now. Thank you, Lord God, that your word opens the eyes of our heart to greater understanding. Your word strengthens faith in us as we face the challenges of our world. Thank you that your word is your power that changes us, changes others, and changes things around us. Thank you, Lord, that in a world that's out of our control, we can find peace in you who is always in control. We can trust you for our future because you're always in charge and you're always faithful. We can find strength in the promises, your promises that you have made known to us in your word. We pray this morning that as we look into your word, that you would again stir faith in us, that you would bring boldness and confidence to believe you and to stand on your truth, your promises, and your word until we see your will, your kingdom established on earth as it is in heaven. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. I want to read from Psalm 119, and I'll read from two translations. So, I'm not going to read this very fast. So, if you'd like to just listen and meditate on the word as it is read to you. Psalm 119, starting with verse 65. It says, "You have dealt well with your servant, O Lord, according to your word. Teach me good judgment and knowledge, for I believe in your commandments. Before I was afflicted, I went astray, but now I keep your word. You are good and do good. Teach me your statutes. The insolent smear me with lies, but with my whole heart I keep your precepts. Their heart is unfeeling like fat, but I delight in your law. It is good for me that I was afflicted, that I might learn your statutes. The law of your mouth is better to me than thousands of gold and silver pieces." That's from the ESV Bible. Again, now, same scripture from the Message Bible. "Be good to your servant, O God. be as good as your word. Train me in good common sense. I am thoroughly committed to living your way. Before I learned to answer you, I wandered all over the place. But now I'm in step with your word. You are good and the source of good. Train me in your goodness. The godless spread lies about me, but I focus my attention on what you are saying. They're bland as a bucket of lard while I dance to the tune of your revelation. My troubles turned out for all the best. They forced me to learn your textbook. Truth from your mouth means more to me than striking it rich in a gold mine. I have heard it many times. The trials make us stronger. They talk about it. They talk about it in sports. They talk about it in business, about our professions, and even about Christianity, or even about our relationship and our walk with God. But as many as we have actual stories of people who have become stronger because of their trials, we also have real stories of people who break down and get destroyed, get bitter, get angry because of the circumstances they go through. So I realize it's not necessarily the trials that make us better, but it is really how we face, how we see it, and how we react that makes the difference. Here the psalmist says in verse 71, "It is good for me that I was afflicted, that I might learn your statutes." The Message Bible says it this way, "My troubles turned out all the best, for they forced me to learn from your textbook." The psalmist is saying, "I learned, I looked at your textbook, I looked at your word, and I learned in the midst of this trial." So let's look at the possibilities that happened in the lives of the possible authors of this psalm. Again, one of the authors, possible authors, is King David. So King David from his youth was already kind of ignored. He was even forgotten when Samuel came to look for God's anointed in his family. The father talked about his other brothers, and his father had to be reminded that he has another son out there with the sheep. When he defeated Goliath, David became a national hero. He was adored he became very important to his whole nation. But in his faithful service to God and king, he became an enemy of the king, eventually a fugitive on the run. Even when he became a king, his trials did not stop. Yet, eventually, David became Israel's most beloved king. He eventually became who God called a man after God's own heart. Another possible author is Daniel the prophet. Think about Daniel. He was captured, taken away from his nation to serve under a pagan king. And he was just faithfully serving the king, serving the kingdom, and serving God. Yet in his faithful service to God, he was accused and thrown into the lion's den. But eventually, Daniel faced even more trials. Today, Daniel is considered one of the major prophets. His life still inspires us, and his words still teaches us. It is true that authenticity is proven after intense scrutiny. The same is true with character. Our true character is revealed in times of trials, crisis, or pressure. It is true about faith as well. Real faith is seen and proven in the midst of testing. But the genuineness of faith is not instant. It is built and strengthened in time. Here we see the journey of the psalmist towards strong faith, conquering faith, and genuine faith. So let's take a look at it, what the steps that the psalmist took towards strong faith. The first thing I'd like us to see is he took the time to be taught and to know the word of God. He says, "You have dealt well with your servant, O Lord, according to your word." He looked at his life. He looked at his trials. He looked at the landscape of how he lived. And he looked at it in the context of the word of God. And his conclusion is, "You have dealt with me according to your word." I have learned through the years that one of the best ways to look at life is to look at it in the context of God's word. Because God's word tells us what life ought to be like. God's word tells us or shows us the possibilities we have in life. The psalmist asked God, "Teach me good judgment. Teach me your statutes." So try to imagine this. In the time of trial, in the time of testing, the psalmist is saying, "Lord, teach me. Teach me how to be a good judge with what's happening around me. Teach me how to be a good judge with how people are reacting around me. Teach me how to be a good judge with the circumstances that are unfolding before me." And he says, the way for God to teach him is, "Lord, teach me your statutes." It is so true that many times in life, in the midst of my own difficulties, in the midst of challenges, things began to change when I began to see life in the light of God's word. When I began to see the truth of God's word in the surroundings, in the circumstances, amongst the people I do life with. We are in trying, confusing, and fearful times, but my perspective has been changed by the word of God. These are opportune times, opportunity to have faith, opportunity for miracles, opportunity to serve and be a blessing, opportunity for time with God and family. Secondly, the psalmist took the steps to believe the word. The psalmist says, "Teach me. I believe your commandments. I believe your word. I choose to live and embrace your word." See, we don't really see the reality of the word until we apply it in our lives. I remember growing up, and one of the biggest books in the bookshelf in our home was this big family Bible. It was huge, it was white, the print was really large, and it felt like it was so heavy just to get and to open. It looked really nice, and interestingly, it was not just in our home that we had a big family Bible, but in the home of my friends, in the home of my relatives, they had this huge family Bible as well. I don't know if you had the same thing in your home, but I realized many, 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 many years later that a good Bible in the shelf is useless. That the Word of God only becomes useful when it is applied in our life. The psalmist took the steps to believe the word of God. I wonder how many times in my life I missed so much because I refused to believe the word of God. But I thank God that today I have seen much as well from the day that God touched my life and the day that the word of God became important, became valuable, and became the final authority and standard of life. Let me encourage us all to take small steps and more steps to believe the word. Think about this. The more you pray for people, the more you heed the word of God that says, "Pray without ceasing, pray at all times." The reality is, the more you'll see answers. Take steps to share the gospel more often to more people. And what will you see? You'll see more salvations. You'll see more disciples. Take the time to lay hands on the sick and pray for healing What will you see? You'll see more healing. The more we apply the Word of God, the more we see the truth of God's Word. I would encourage us to take steps to give your tithe, to be generous, to live right, to obey the Word of God. And guess what? You'll see more of God in your life. You will end up stronger. You'll end up more mature. We will all see the truth of God's Word. When trials come, you know that you know that the Word of God is true. Trying to imagine David when he faced Goliath. Remember that story? Goliath was a seasoned warrior. Goliath was a victorious warrior. Goliath was how many times bigger than David? Goliath was an expert. Here comes a shepherd. Never been a military man. Never saw a battle. Just a faithful shepherd taking care of the sheep. And then Goliath comes and David and Goliath finally meet. And Goliath looks at David and he laughs. And he tells the nation of Israel, "Am I a dog that you bring out this stick before me? Who is this guy that you're bringing before me?" And he starts taunting David. And David looks at Goliath and says, "You come to me with a sword and a spear." But he said, "But I come to you in the name of God Most High, of whom you have defied today, and He will deliver you into my hand." What was David doing? David was simply going back to the promise of God. David was simply going back to the Word of God. And because he took a step of faith to trust God and to believe the promises of God, David saw a mighty warrior, an experienced giant, fall before God. Take steps of faith. Take steps to believe the Word. Lastly, the psalmist took the pains to treasure the Word. "The law of your mouth is better to me than thousands of gold and silver pieces. With my whole heart I keep your precepts." That's what the psalmist says. With my whole heart I keep your precepts. He treasured the Word of God. It no longer matters what is around me, my circumstances or my situation. I still choose to treasure your Word. No wonder the psalmist said, "My affliction is good to me and good for me," because in the midst of that limitation, in the midst of that struggle, in the midst of that affliction, he found the truth of the Word of God. He went back to the Word. He went back to the promises of God. He went back to God and he found God faithful. He found the Word as truth, and the Word changed who he was and what happened around him. I'm looking forward to the end of this, because with all the time that has been given to us, as we spend time in the Word, as we spend time with God, as we spend time worshiping God, as we spend time praying to God, we can literally walk out of this as spiritual giants, more mature than the beginning of this, in greater faith than when this all started, ready to see the hand of God take change and take over our nation and our world all over again, ready to see the promises of God come true, ready to be used by God to a world that is in fear. This trial will be a stepping stone to bigger and better things. This test will be conquered. This obstacle will be scaled. Victory in God and with God is at hand, because the Word of God says so. Let us pray and let's worship God again. Lord, we thank you that we have your word to stand on, to rely on. We have you to trust and to believe with and to walk with in the midst of these trying times we live in. We are not alone. We are not helpless, because your power is with us as we continue to walk with you.
Ang pagpuri ko tanging sa'yo, sa'yo lamang iniaalay. O Panginoon, ang puso ko sa'yo magpakailanman. Ang papuri ko tanging sa'yo, sa'yo lamang iniaalay. Panginoon, ang puso ko sa'yo lamang. Sa'yo lamang. Mananatili sa'yo, lilim at sasamba sa dakong lihim. Mananatili sa'yo, dilim ng masumpungan ka sa dakong lihim. Masumpungan ka pagkat ka'y ika'y darating, ika'y darating, Jesus.
Lord, thank you, Lord God, for your life-changing presence. Sometimes, or many times, we don't understand, Lord, how setting a time to sing songs to you and pour out our hearts to you can actually change us. But it does. It changes our perspective. It puts faith, stirs up faith in us. It puts courage in us as we continue to face the days that you have set for us. Let us take steps of faith to continue praying today for our nation and for others. Let us pray that God would bring healing and restoration to our nation. Lord, we thank you, Lord God. Lord, your word says, if my people who are called by my name humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and heal their land. Lord, I thank you, Lord God, that even as many of your people have humbled themselves, have come down on their knees to pray in this difficult situation in our world, in our nation, we pray that you would hear our prayers, that you would heal our land. Lord, we pray for a miracle, Lord God. Turn this virus, this crisis around now, we ask you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Flatten the curve. Bring healing to this nation. We ask you and we trust you in Jesus' name. Lord, we pray for our friends and relatives who are infected, who are having difficulty even during this time. Lord, we thank you that your word says in Isaiah 53:5, but he was wounded for our transgressions, he was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his stripes we are healed. Lord, we thank you, Lord God, Lord, that you have paid the price for healing for everyone, Lord God. So we pray right now, Lord, that you would step into the hotel rooms of our friends, hospital rooms of our friends, our relatives, Lord God, and that you would breathe life into them right now. We rebuke this virus. Let it dissolve in the name of Jesus. And we pray, Lord God, that you would bring complete healing now according to your word. In Jesus' name. Let us now pray for our frontliners that God would protect them and keep them virus free. Psalm 91, verse 1 says this: He who dwells in the shelter of the Most High will abide in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say to the Lord, my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust, for he will deliver you from the snare of the fowler and from the deadly pestilence. Lord, I thank you, Lord God, Lord, that you would protect our frontliners. You would protect the people who are doing the work to protect the rest of the nation. We pray, Lord God, that you will set them free. You will protect them from the schemes of the evil one. You will protect them from sickness. You will protect them from disease. That you will keep them in health. We thank you, Lord God, for the truth of your word. Lord, we pray, Lord God, for your children, for your people who are serving in the front lines. Let them even be a source of hope. Let them be even a voice of faith. Let them be, Lord God, a mouthpiece for your gospel. That even during these trying times, the people they meet, the people they serve, the people they minister to will encounter you. In Jesus' name, amen. Now let me pray for you as I declare God's blessing over you. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you for joining us again. It is our prayer that we continue to grow in our knowledge and our experience of God, that we will continue to be used by God to be a blessing to those around us. God bless you. See you again next time.